The European Union has initiated measures to impose sanctions on members of Niger's military junta, making a significant development 3 months after they seized power in a coup. On Monday, the EU Council revealed that it had taken steps to enact a framework that would empower it to impose sanctions on individuals and entities found responsible for actions that pose a threat to the peace, stability, and security of Niger. The Council explicitly stated that these sanctions will target individuals who undermine Niger's constitutional order, democracy, or rule of law. Additionally, those who engage in human rights violations or abuses will also face sanctions. The range of sanctions will encompass travel bans, asset freezes, and restrictions on providing funds to those who are sanctioned. EU Foreign Policy Chief Joseph Borrell emphasized the EU support for the efforts of the West African bloc, ECOWAS, and sent a clear message that military coups come at a cost. With today's decision, the EU strengthens its support to ECOWAS efforts and sends a clear message: military coups bear costs. However, it's important to note that the EU has left room for humanitarian exemptions to asset freeze measures. The European Union's decision comes in a wake of sanctions already imposed on Niger by ECOWAS and the suspension of aid by the United States government.
A widow of a Pakistani journalist who was shot dead by police in Kenya after he fled arrest in his home country filed a lawsuit today over his death. Arshad Sharif was a critic of Pakistan's powerful military establishment and supporter of former Premier Imran Khan. Kenyan police opened fire on his car at a roadblock outside the capital Nairobi a year ago. Javria Siddiqui, one of Sharif's two wives, told the French news agency AFP in Islamabad last week that she was filing a lawsuit. Her lawyer confirmed it had been lodged at Kenya's High Court today, a year to the day since the late night killing. Last year, Kenyan officials said it was a case of mistaken identity, and officers believed they were firing on a stolen vehicle involved in an abduction. Siddiqui, however, alleges her husband was killed in a targeted attack. A Kenyan information technology practitioner created Wakili, which means lawyer, an artificial intelligence tool to help Kenyan citizens learn the country's laws and how to seek justice. It is aimed at a wide range of users, including individuals, legal professionals, and organizations in need of assistance with legal issues. Wakili's developer was inspired by how people, including his father, struggle to get justice. Muhammad Yusuf reports.
Just 1 in 10 Kenyans seek justice in a government court, according to a survey by the country's judiciary. Kenyans say their inability to get justice in court is because they cannot afford legal fees for a lawyer, don't understand the legal process and procedures, and face delays in resolving cases. Naftali Obuoni's family encountered similar difficulties when his father was unexpectedly terminated from his job. The IT practitioner developed an artificial intelligence tool called Wakili, meaning lawyer, which is designed to help Kenyans pursue justice by providing information on legal matters and guiding them on how to access the legal system.
Wakili.org is basically a bot, it's a chatbot. This is where you can go if you have any issues. It might even not be directly law-related, but it might be related to things that you face in society, and you want to know what is your course of action and you need guidance. It understands all laws in Kenya, meaning whether it's customary, whether it is civil, criminal, whether it is property, land, all those laws, it already understands them. And it doesn't list you the laws, it interprets for you.
Launched just a week ago, more than 2,800 people have engaged with the Wakili AI tool, seeking guidance on property ownership procedures, gender-based violence case inquiries, and contract drafting for employers. James Mwindi, a software developer, is one of many users benefiting from Wakili. He is using AI tool to draft client agreements, which is more cost-effective than hiring legal services.
This has kind of helped us now formalize all our agreements with our clients so that now, before we begin any software development project for a client, we're able to have a draft contract, a draft non-disclosure agreement agreed, and they feel at ease as a client because they know now the process is formal. And on our end, it has also now reduced the costs.
Some lawyers have voiced concern that incorporating AI into the profession, much like in other fields, may lead to a decrease in their income and a reduction in the number of people seeking their services. Geoffrey Nyanga is an advocate of the High Court of Kenya. He is embracing the technology as it makes his work easier.
Research consumes most of lawyers' time because research is based on what cases you're handling and what particular area of the law. This narrows it down. Once you ask that question, it narrows it down. You don't have to start broadly and then narrow down. It narrows it down for you.
The developers aim to incorporate a voice recognition system into the program to make it accessible to millions of Kenyans.